Welcome everyone. It's Julie Boye here. I'm so excited to have my guest with me today. Welcome, Erin Esch. Hello.
Hello.
So Erin is the owner of Total Wellness Milton, and we actually met through this organization, Mompreneurs. I've mentioned it a few times, and it's a beautiful community of entrepreneurs that actually may or may not be moms. It's not a requirement, but Erin, like me, is also a mom of two beautiful children. And she has a pretty incredible journey that started from really family emergency and then turned into a daily practice and business that includes self-love as a total foundation. So when I asked for people from this beautiful mompreneurs group, I said, I'm doing this project. Erin raised her hand and said, this is absolutely what I want to talk about. It's how I live. So can we connect? And so Erin, I'm super excited, and I've had the chance to hear your story, but I would love for you to share with us a little bit about how you got to where you are today with Total Wellness Milton.
Great. Thank you so much for having me. It is a great pleasure to finally be in a position to tell my story and to let you know kind of how Total Wellness came to be. We call it Total Wellness as a short form, and then we added Milton because we wanted to really make it localized in the beginning. Our story did start mostly with my family. So in 2015, we were at our family cottage having a good time. My family's super close. We go away a lot. And my husband dove off our dock and over my uncle and ended up hitting his head on the bottom of the lake. Now, being a lifeguard for about 20 years, I said, we should go make sure you don't have a concussion. And I drove him from Minden to Halliburton over all these bumpy hills to the hospital, and it ended up being not only a concussion, but he'd broken his spine in 5 places. And that was obviously not what I or the nurse had thought would be the outcome. So we were in a state of emergency, and they evacuated him from Halliburton Hospital down to St. Mike's Labor Day weekend. And I should add that I was a teacher, so that just added to the stress of my classroom starting on Tuesday. This was Sunday night. We had 2 small children. They were back at the cottage having a nap. And the 3 days that he was at the hospital trying to find out if he needs spinal surgery, in one instance, the emergency doctor wanted me to sign paperwork to put rods in his spine with a 40% chance they would kill him instantly. And this was at 3 in the morning while I'm standing there in a bikini. So it was kind of a very startling event in our life. And we've been married for, I guess, 8 years at this point. So we've been married for a long time. We had these 2 small children, and I knew definitely what was weird was they said he'll never be able to move his head again. And in my state of shock, thought he'll never be able to play volleyball. And my husband loves volleyball, like was like an offset champion for 5 years. So that was what had me say, no, we came to talk to the specialist. If he's stable, I think we should wait. Yeah. I don't think my husband will ever forgive me.
The volleyball came to mind first.
Yeah. Well, no, because he spent 3 days on a spinal board. So he was waiting for MRI.
3 days?
And because anybody who comes in with something stuck in them gets an MRI before they take it out. Now, he was stable, so he got admitted and sent to the 9th floor waiting for MRI. And because I couldn't get time off work, my dad ended up going to be with him in case he had to go for surgery. But there was no time frame in when we would know if he needed to go for surgery. Oh, so I went to work on the first day of school. Well, I went home to get my kids ready for school, got them ready for school, sent them to school. And I went to school on the first day like nothing had happened. Although I was waiting to find out if my husband was going for surgery and if they would still have a dad by the end of the day. So quite the same as previous years. Yeah. It turns out he was okay. They spinal specialist doctor on at St. Mike's is the most amazing doctor. I thank him 1,000 times. We send him Christmas cards and baskets every year. He had my husband wear a neck brace for 6 months. He couldn't work. He couldn't drive. He couldn't look down. He never took it off for 6 months. My husband wore that neck brace. And for the first 2 months, every Friday, I took him back for MRI and x-ray because if anything shifted, he'd broken his C1, C2, C7, T4, T5. So that was quite a collateral.
That's a lot.
And he broke the spiny process off his C7. So when you bend your head forward, that bump, he doesn't have one anymore.
So Erin and I are having this like kinesiology discussion because we both have a background in kin. So sorry, thank you for explaining. We're going really fast. I'm following you because I know exactly what you're talking about. But the reason I kind of went, whoa, when you talked about all, like, that's also like a long distance along the spine.
Yeah.
To have so many breaks. And also, like, I am so strict about not diving. So I love you that you were like, the lifeguard in you is like, I better check this. And I, you know, my husband will do it sometimes. I'm like, no, you cannot dive if it is not deep enough, because it just takes one little mistake. So now I can also share this with my husband, who is a volleyball player, that the next time I see him diving, so, you know, not that he kind of listens to me now, but that mistake.
Oh, no. What? I get you. Every time we go to a pool and it says shallow, no diving, I make him read it to me. So I totally get where you're coming from.
Right? This is so funny. It's so funny how you and I are connected in these really neat ways that we didn't realize. So here you are. So your first day back to school as a teacher, kids are at school, your husband is in the hospital. He ends up not being okay, but your life for the next 6 months is, did you kind of feel like you were in a bit of a waiting period?
It was, yeah. And so I could explain the ritual that happened. For the kids, it was imperative that it stayed the same because they were little. They were in grade one in kindergarten. So they were small enough to not really grasp how serious it was, but definitely understood when dad came home, because he came home from the hospital on the first day with a neck brace. And I had to say, no hugging dad, no jumping up, nothing. He's going to try to make it upstairs. And for little kids, it's hard to hear. You can't do what normally you would do, especially because my husband is a very active guy. He's so lucky that he was so active that when he broke it, his muscle spasm, because he would have not survived had his body not gone into a kind of a lock mode and kept him safe until we got to help.
Wow.
So that was hard, because it was hard being his wife and seeing him be that dependent and being that helpless and being that nervous for him. But it was worse being the mother. And every morning, I ended up not sleeping in the same bedroom as him because I was worried I would roll over or do something and shift him. So I would wake up, I would have a shower, I would cry in the bathroom, and then I would go make sure he was alive. And then I would go wake up the kids. And that was what we did every day for 6 months. And then after 6 months, his neck brace came off. He needed severe rehab because he lost all the muscle control in his neck because he'd been wearing a neck brace. So I upgraded my personal training qualifications to do fascial stretching and trigger points. So that helps when you have the knots behind your shoulders and all the muscles when they tense up after injury. It just helps release that pressure and help with circulation and healing. So he was able to do that, but not chiropractor. They didn't want anything to move his spine for 2 years. So we were able to do simple stretching routines and the fascial stretching and trigger points, as long as it wasn't along the spinal column.
Okay.
So I did that. And he, by all accounts, is like this miracle. And Dr. Ron and all his residents would tell you he's the guy that should have died. And my husband claims it as being like, he fought the lake and he won. Like, it's a big thing in our household that like he fought the earth and he was stronger than it. Or it's not as funny to me still as it is to him.
Yeah.
But we lived through what I thought was going to be the biggest emergency a family could live through. He should have died. And he didn't. And we made it through. Then a year after that, I got injured by a student and I had a concussion good enough that I couldn't go up and downstairs. I couldn't talk. I wasn't able to drive for 6 months. And I went into what they called expedited recovery 5 months after the concussion that had me ill to the point of shutting down every day for 2 months. And that was, I don't think there is anything called expedited concussion recovery. I don't think we know enough about brain injuries to really say this is the best method. But I never, to this day, can't go into a gym with all the reverberating sound. My husband and I tried to have lunch in a food court today, and I couldn't do it because all the high school students were there, and I can't pinpoint where sound's coming from when there's multiple sounds. And this is 2 years after my injury, so it's still something that I live with.
You know, what's interesting is, and I know we're getting to like the today of your story, but I feel like this is important to point out as well, is that because this whole talk is about self-love and self-care and being kind to yourself. And I think what you're pointing out is that we don't know enough about brain injuries that to, like, how many times have you met someone who's hit their head and have a concussion and they're like, oh, but I'm fine.
Yeah.
And they're not. And it's like, because they don't feel they have permission to just do nothing, which is the only way your brain can really heal, like, and have the proper care, which only exists in a very few places, right? Yep. And I actually think that's actually part of self-love, because I'm thinking in my, I already have like four or five friends in my head that I can think of that are years after a concussion and have never recovered, you know?
Oh, so, and I feel guilty as a teacher. We would get students that would come in and from hockey had a concussion or something like that. And we'd get this note that was, they can't participate for 2 weeks. And then they would tell us, I can't be in the gym even. And I would, in my mind, not understanding it, not really get, are they really injured? Are they faking it? Are they upset right. that they can't participate with other yeah. people? And now I get it. Like, I totally get it. And I don't think you really can until you're stripped of all your abilities. Like,
yeah.
I couldn't go up and downstairs. I had to bum scoot up and downstairs as an adult. So like, that's really hard for your dignity.
My friend, I have been there myself. So I've done the bum scooch up and down the stairs. So I get it. And so then, so now you've dealt with this emergency with your health and your recovery.
Yep.
And then?
So everyone's back at school and here we are in 2018. And my daughter received a concussion on the second day of school. The school didn't know it had happened in class, but I came home to an unconscious Ooh. Child face down in vomit.
What?
And that was probably the most scared I've ever been. I thought Rob was the worst. Then for myself, I was worried that I wasn't going to make it at times, but Abby was definitely the worst. And because we live really close to Milton District Hospital, thank goodness, yeah. I scooped her up and ran down to the car and told my oldest daughter to tell my husband and my dad. Both people were, it was who could get to Abby first. So who could get home to get her help quickest.
Yeah.
And I made it home first. So then I grabbed Abby and as I'm carrying her down to the car, she's waking up and she'd had carrots and she's throwing up carrots down my shirt and passing back out and throwing up down my shirt and passing back out. And I like roll her into the car and I drive the 2 seconds to the hospital, pick her back up. And as I run into emerge, they open the double doors and bring a stretcher and have me roll her onto that and whisk her away. And it was clearly like she was in high emergency for yeah. her concussion. We were there for 8 hours while they got her to stay conscious. They gave her a freezy. We had to wait 2 hours. They gave her some muffin. We had to wait 2 hours. And we were waiting to see if she needed CT. They really don't like giving kids CT. So they said, if you can wait it out, then right. that's better than us rushing her to CT and putting her through that. Okay. And I have no problem waiting. Again, my husband was yeah. on a spinal board for three days. So 8 hours wasn't such a big deal. It was a date night. And that's why my dad was coming down. So we had to call the restaurant and tell them, we're not going to make it. And didn't realize, like, I just survived a concussion, but now it was my child who was going to do that. And she had to come out of school for 10 days. She couldn't read books. She couldn't watch TV. She couldn't, again, like you said, you do nothing to help your brain recover.
Yeah.
So try telling an athlete who's a flyer for the cheer sport Sharks, you're out. And they just done their choreography for the season. School had just started. She was so excited. And it was, sorry, you can't do anything. And then it ended up being, I stayed home for the first 24 hours. My husband stayed home for the 48 hour. And then she went to my parents' house. My mom's a nurse. And so she stayed with grandma and granddad for the rest of the time because it was just easier with not being able to take time off work and needing someone to monitor her to make sure if anything happened that was suspicious, they would send her back to the hospital.
So here you are, Erin, in a very short period of time where you have three traumatic injuries in your family. How the heck do you get from that? And now you actually care for others. Like, this is what's, I think, the most powerful part of your story is, you know, your story could have gone one of two ways, really. One way, which would have been pretty dark and sad and depressive. And that would have been okay. That would have been a choice that, you know, a road that you followed. And you chose a different route. You chose a route where you are now in service to others. You work with clients, you help them based on your experience and what you've learned. How was there like a moment where you're like, I have to start helping others? Was it just
it's funny because there were like lots of little moments that when you're in waiting rooms and waiting a long time, they play in your head over and over again. So from Abby's experience with her concussion, she was just dizzy more often as you are with concussion. She fell off her bunk bed and hit her back. And so we took her to the hospital just to get it checked. Our family history with backs is not as high as I would like.
Yeah.
And they looked at the x-ray originally for a break and said everything was fine. And then when we got called back into the doctor's office a couple of days later, they informed us that Abby has spina bifida occulta, which for those of you who aren't spinal specialists out there means when she was being formed, they didn't form the spinal column completely around the nerves in her back. from her L1 to her L5, so your lower back pain, if that helps you figure out where that is. And it's something that we would have never noticed, but they did tell us that she would be one of those cases where if she had given birth and there was lower back pressure, she would be one of the cases where she could have been paralyzed from the waist down.
Is this your older daughter now?
My younger daughter.
Oh, your younger, the one who had the concussion too?
Yes. So this all happened to one.
Okay, I didn't realize this was all of a couple same months. Daughter that had the concussion and then also got diagnosed with the.
Yes.
Okay.
So her coming out of cheer was probably a good thing because she won't be able to go back to cheer. Right. They don't want her to do the lifting because she's not allowed to do any heavy lifting because of lower back. Yeah. And she's not allowed to do any things that would have her falling from a great height because of lower back.
Yeah.
But they did because Abby loved cheerleading. She loved it, but she loved the tumbling part. And because one of the things that they're watching for is loss of muscle control, they want her to continue to do gymnastics because it'll be a very telltale sign if she all of a sudden can't do something that she used to be able to do. So she was happy because they gave her the green light after a year of investigation to do it. And she actually started back in gymnastics this past fall.
We had
her in this beginner intermediate group because we weren't sure how she would do. And then because she had to take this year off and she was, and that eight understood everything that was going on. We weren't sure how her confidence would be. And now we just spoke with her coach and she's in the advanced level after Christmas because she's now like back to back handsprings and doing back tucks. And she made all of those gains back where if someone told me I could hurt myself if I did something, I'm not sure I would be as brave to do it.
Yeah.
But she's a little kid and little kids are so resilient. But Sabrina's acutely aware, as you had mentioned about the resources in our community. Now there's doctors and there's physio and there's osteopath and there's all these great things that you go to and your doctor refers you to, but there's a million other things that come up when you're in an emergency. Finances, what happened with our mortgage when one of us wasn't working, what happened with our nutrition when we were waiting in hospital rooms or on the go or on medications that we couldn't eat certain foods with. All of those things became factors in our life for 4 years and are still to this day factors in our life. And we realized how much we were at a benefit because I have that background and being a nutritionist and working as a OCT certified health teacher, I knew a lot of these things. And even from Rob's perspective, being a lifeguard is probably what had me go and take him to the hospital.
Sure. Yeah.
We were just so fortunate, but there are families out there that I don't think have that background. And it's so, so sad to me when we would meet people in waiting rooms and we would be comparing stories because you're waiting a lot. And they don't know about all the things and all the steps and all the resources. And so you're almost sharing war stories and sharing those. Have you checked this out? Have you applied for this? Do you know about that? Oh, you had to change your diet. Try this instead. And all those little things that make it easier is what formed Total Wellness. It became almost like a side project for a couple friends that we had. And then when Abby's diagnosis came back as spina bifida, I looked at my husband and I said, who should be we call it the coordinator of care, meaning who deals with all the doctors, all the changes, all the medicine, all everything. He travels for work. He's an engineer. So he was in South Africa for all of September.
And
I decided October 1st that coordinator of care was going to be me and that was going to be full time. So I resigned from Peel and now work our business out of our house. We do in our garage, we have where we do our stretching programs, and in our house is where we do our nutrition counseling and goal setting and work with clients who are able-bodied.
So this is amazing because you really did take something that was, and you listened to others, and while you were going through your own trauma, you were listening to other people, you were trying to be of service, which I think is really beautiful. I do agree with you. I have a similar background. I don't have quite the same training as you do, but I have a similar background in terms of like, I understand how the body works. Like even just understanding basic anatomy, I think most people just don't because it's taught in like one science course in high school.
Yeah.
So you don't even remember how the body systems really work. So unless you're in a field that deals with human anatomy, you're not even going to think about these things. And it's that people don't even know what they don't know. So they can't ask a question.
Absolutely. So
I love that you've created a business around this of being of service to those in your community. I know first you said that's where you're going to start. I actually think that's super important to start at home, being of service to those that need you in your community. I think that can be a really beautiful business and a way of serving others. So tell me how this self-love part fits into this business in terms of you serving your clients.
I think it came from, now when I got hurt, it was probably where I realized it the most because when my husband got hurt, I took care of him and the kids. And that was very natural. But when I got hurt, he had to take on my responsibilities as well. And he hadn't been in that role before. Not that we don't 50-50 parent, but there are just things that because I'm there and I drop them off at school or I pick them up, he just got to see everything from my side of the fence. And I think that opened his eyes to just, we could empathize with each other because we both had to do that. I had to do dad things when he was out. He had to do mom things when I was out. Yeah. And then we could have these really frank conversations because we're one of the very few couples, I think, who literally were like, thank God you survived because I don't know how I would do it without you. And we realized that when it came to our child, we were both on the same side of the fence. And it was, how are we going to support each other and support our children and follow the instructions and make sure that in all of this panic, we're the calm voice that the kids can turn to? Because at the end of the day, you're the one saying goodnight to them and you need to make sure that they go to bed not panicked and not frazzled and not worried about all the medications and all the doctor's appointments and all those things. That we did a few things. We decided when we moved into our new house, because this is where we knew we were going to have our center, so we decided to pick a property that we're putting in a saltwater pool for post-surgical recovery.
Wonderful.
That's in 2022. Great. We last year bought a hot tub. So one of the things that Abby has as an issue is her core temperature drops too low. And so her doctor was a little concerned about that. And with my, I have crushed feet from a student as well. So I have a crushed injury on my right foot. I have bad circulation. I go to osteo for that. They said, then you should be trying to go into hot tubs. We put a hot tub in the side of our house so that we can jump into that and warm up. And when we work with clients who have extreme soreness or tenderness from stretching, or especially if it's muscle cramping, then you can go in the hot tub as well. And it actually helps people get better range of motion so they can stretch things out a little bit further once their muscles are warmed up almost artificially. You can do it through physical movement, but a lot of people have had such restricted movement that it's almost too hard for them to get their muscles warmed up enough. So you go into the hot tub and you stretch them out a little bit further.
That's so clever. Beautiful ways. And it's true when you like, when you trade roles with your spouse, how different, and it is, it's just, my husband and I talk about this a lot, is that, you know, I'm a homeschool parent. I work from home. He can't possibly imagine what I have to do in a day. And it just doesn't even fit into his mind. Not because he doesn't care, not because he's not helpful, because his role, he leaves the house, he goes to work, he comes back at the end of the day, and all this happens when he's not there. So I like how you said that, you know, you guys really are being more aware of what the other person's responsibility is. And then also that you made that choice to say, okay, I'm going to be the one who's going to be the primary person to take care of, you know, of the kids, like 100%, including this whole care guide. And then at the same time, I get to pursue this beautiful dream and this business that's supporting our family as well. So I adore that. I would love for you to share with us, I always ask people when we talk, if you could inspire people to make one change today. So just one thing. It can be starting something new. It can be stopping something. It can be creating a new habit. What would that be for you?
For me, absolutely 100% is wake up and be grateful. Do gratitude. So we write down 10 things we're grateful for every morning. A lot of the times it's Dr. On. Okay, whenever there's anniversaries or special, it's a doctor that saved my husband's life. But then it's also simple things. It's the fact that like my dog was at my bedside. It was that my daughters were really kind in a moment yesterday. It almost gives you a chance of reflection every morning when you wake up. There's going to be 1,000 things that go wrong. But if you can be grateful, and even grateful in an emergency, I'm grateful that the nurse listened to me. I'm grateful that, you know, there was an extra blanket in the hospital. I'm grateful that they let us go home and get extra clothes for Abby because she was cold. All of those things that you think, it was a really bad day, but these good moments happened. You end up changing your mind chemistry. And if you change your mind chemistry to one that's a positive outlook, I'm pretty sure you can get through anything. My grandmother smoked 2 packs of cigarettes a day, lived through World War II in England, and lived till she was 90, the happiest lady ever, because she saw every situation with a positive outlook. And not that I suggest anybody smoke or anything like that, but if she could eat dripping sandwiches and make it to 90, I'm pretty sure a lot of that had to do with her mental state.
Gratitude. So we don't really know each other. This is actually our first conversation. And I know people are going to start to think that I'm setting up these interviews, but I'm really not. And there is a sign that says grateful behind me. But you may or may not know this, but so my business is actually called Wake Up with Gratitude. And my goal is to help people to, this is if people can just be inspired to wake up every single day and give thanks. That's actually my mission in the world, is to just inspire people to wake up every single day and give thanks for this gift of another day and the opportunity to be of service to others and make a difference in this world, which it sounds like you're doing. Erin, I've adored our talk. I'm so excited. This is, I think, the beginning of something really beautiful, a new friendship, a new connection. Where do people find you, Erin? What's the best way to connect with you?
Well, we are on Instagram, and we are Fit In Spite Of It, all one word. On Facebook, you can find me under Erin Esch. I have two accounts. So there's one that you'll see a lot more personal things, and one that will be a little bit more of a
business one,
fitness. And you can tell in the picture. One, I look a little more glamorous, and the other one, I look like I'm working out. You're welcome to follow me on either one of those.
Okay.
As well, we have a website. It's totalwellnessmilton with dashes in between each word .com. But that's where you can find information about all the programs that we're doing, all the workshops that we run, and everything that's on the docket for us coming into 2020.
That's so exciting. Well, we'll make sure that all of this is written in the notes. Of course, if you're watching the video, you can just look at the notes. If you're listening to the audio, same thing, just check out the notes. If you don't, but it's, I'm sure if you Google Total Wellness Milton,
yeah, we're Google searchable, Erin, all those places.
So, well, Erin, thank you so incredibly much for your time. I'm so glad we connected today. Thanks so much for being a part of this.
Thank you so much for having me.